Please welcome John Cleese.
Thank you. Thank you.
Are you often on crutches yourself? Are you?
No, but I have an artificial knee and an artificial hip, which so is why I could no longer do a funny walk. Anyway, I'm not allowed to make jokes tonight.
Because of the ribs.
Because of his ribs.
Because of the ribs. Now, if I make a joke, it's going to be very painful. Oh. He could sue me. And I haven't even paid off the alimony yet, so I'll be in real trouble.
We had a little chat about this.
Yes,
it's an agreement.
Yeah.
So I thought I'd summarise the plot of Moby Dick.
Yeah, or we can talk politics in Sweden.
Oh, it's Sweden. I thought it was Italy.
You're close.
No, it's very Italian, isn't it?
Well, it is very Italian.
Yeah, the style of the new election, and it's quite Italian.
Yeah, it's all very, very strange because we're used to you being so stable all the time and sensible. And now you're getting like the rest of the world. Though not like America, please God.
No.
Oh, dear, what a mess that is.
What a mess.
John, it's great to have you back on the show.
Yes, it's great for you to have me back on the
show. Yes, it is. I would say it's an honor.
You all right?
Yeah, it's... this is my game face, so I'm hurting inside. But then,
He's hurting inside.
You know, he can stand a lot of pain. Yeah.
He can stand it.
Yeah.
God, he's butch, isn't he?
Yeah.
He is.
He's a real toughie. And I was such a wuss. You know, I was always such a wuss. I was very tall.
Yeah.
Very, very tall and incredibly skinny. When I was 12, I was 193. When I was 12, I was taller than all the teachers. But I was so physically weak.
12 and 193?
Yeah, and I was so physically weak that I was a bag of bones and an embarrassment. This guy's always been a huge, great butch athlete, haven't you?
Well,
yes.
Not always.
Not always?
It takes a little, you know, when you work out and it takes them and...
Yeah.
Yeah, just, you know, hit some weights.
Oh,
and
easy. For Christ's sake. Jesus. God. Fuck it. Easy.
Do you have any experience with that, working out? Do you often...
I used to work out. I stopped a year ago when I was 74. Yeah. I thought, I can't do all this travelling and take exercise. And also, I'm having a baby. I'm sorry, you're all right?
I'm all right. It's actually healing, I think.
You're not really first and foremost a performer, you're a writer.
I'm a writer, that's what I claim in the book. But of course, people don't believe me because when they see me, they see me acting. They don't see me sitting at a desk writing.
Well, you wrote the book.
I wrote the book. And I wrote it, you'll love this.
With a pencil?
With a pencil.
No computer.
Serious, no computer. Right. And it's got a brilliant new invention on the end, which is called an India rubber. And you write in the book, and then if you've written it wrongly and it doesn't sound right when you read it out, then you can rub it out.
No, you're kidding me.
Seriously. really. Yeah. And then you can write it again.
So new technology.
That's how I did it. Though I have about 8 exercise books full of my handwritten pencils. Isn't that silly?
Is that how you write your scripts as well?
Yeah.
What I didn't know about you was that you've been a serious actor as well.
Scroll.
You've been a serious actor as well. You did Faust.
Yes.
It's incredible. It's hard to visualize.
It was very.
You were the Lucifer, the devil, right?
Yes. I was 16. It was my first dramatic role, and they wanted me to play the devil, Lucifer. Okay. Not a good start. The thing is, I was so skinny, like I was saying, so incredibly skinny, that the director, for some reason, put me in black tights. Look, I've got very skinny legs. Look at that. Look how skinny those legs are. Look at them. See? See?
Yeah.
Is it? I was so skinny, I could have played a flamingo. So,
can we have some makeup in here? For the
And when I first walked out to do my first line, I was supposed to come out and say, I am Lucifer. And the whole audience was supposed to go... And of course, they fell about with laughter. They just roared with laughter.
Do you sometimes, when you watch your old material, can you make yourself laugh?
Oh, yeah. Well, a lot of the time, you forget jokes. But you forget them. Hmm?
Do you find the silly walks funny?
No, I never liked the silly walks. I thought it was a stupid sketch. And it was a boring bit of writing. It was written by Michael Palin and Terry Jones, who aren't very good anyway. And it was only the sheer brilliance of my performance that made the sketch it was. But I never thought it was very good. And when we started to do the touring show, the stage show, the first night, I said I didn't want to do it, you see. And they said, oh, no, you have to do it. And I said, it's not funny, I'm not going to do it. So I go on the first night in Southampton, and it lays a complete egg. There's no laughter at all. And I am terrific about it. I'm so happy. But I walk off the stage and I say, you see, it's not funny, I'm never doing it again. And they said, oh, just one more night. Just do it tomorrow. I said, no. They said, please, just one more. And if it does, they don't laugh tomorrow night. And I went on the next night at Brighton, and the bastards laughed. And I was stuck with a bloody thing for the rest of the tour.
And it was
quite hard work. I mean, not for someone like you, but for an old puff like me.
Last time, John, when you were on this show...
It's the first time in my life that I've been on the front page of international newspapers.
That's the thing.
Do you know about this?
That's the thing. Because last time John was on this show,
right,
he made front page news all over the world.
Yep.
And not because of the show, but because of the trip back.
All right.
Because of the Icelandic volcano. What was it called? The grit, the...
Yes, and the ash...
Nothing could fly.
No, and you were stuck in Oslo. We were recording in Oslo.
That's right, we did the show.
And, yes.
And then I said, well, how am I going to get out? And I'd had my personal assistant with me, and I said, well, what can we do? Can we hire a hot air balloon?
Hope for the wind to blow in the right direction.
That's right. Is there a submarine you can take by that?
There is actually one you might know about this.
Oh, good. You're wrong side. But we tried everything.
Yes.
And the only...
And then we called the cab.
And we called the cab.
Do you know what? The driver is here. So I want to introduce now, and because I thought it might be a wonderful reunion.
Yes.
With you and the taxi driver, Glenn Powley, please come in.
Yeah. Hello, John.
Sit down for a minute, will you? Hi.
I don't know how you kept going all that time, but I don't remember you taking a break, really.
No. You want to go to Brussels at once? I ask you, you want to stop over to sleep? No.
It was just amazing. And you know what? Well, the extraordinary thing was, right at the beginning, Kettle, his friend who was putting my show on, and he said to me, would you do one interview with NRK? Because it's a good news story. So I said, sure. The rest of the trip, he was getting calls every half an hour from all the news organizations everywhere in even in Germany, when we went through Germany. Am I not right? And I thought to myself, this is ridiculous. I got to Brussels at 2:30 in the morning, got out of the car, two cameramen. I said, go away. I said, I'm tired. And I thought, thank God that's over. And the next morning,
I
went down to breakfast, let me tell you. Yeah. And I got the International Herald Tribune, as it was called. And I opened the first, and there I was in the first paragraph, the biggest story, the comedian John Cleese. And of course, everybody thought it was so extraordinary. But the next day, everyone was doing it. Everyone was hiring taxis from Portugal.
Tell me, how was this trip for you?
Yeah, I just get one day warning. I was in a football game and Tietil called me. Do you want to go to Brussels with John? What? How many miles is that? So we figure out and he asked, how much you shall have? Okay, I call you. The problem was I shall also have my 40 years birthday that weekend. And my wife was pregnant, almost ready to get a baby. And I say yes. I do everything for John.
So was it like the kind of passenger that wanted to talk all the time, or was he more the quiet type, or is it?
No, he's funny here, but in the car,
boring.
He was just like your grandfather else.
I'm only funny if I get paid.
That's what I mean. Something must have happened.
Tell me, what I find most important here is, did you get back to your wife giving birth?
Yes. I come home Sunday, and Sunday evening we go to the hospital.
Oh. He drove her to the hospital.
And then the baby waits, my Therese wait 1 day, so she come on my 40 years birthday.
Oh.
The same day.
Great.
That's
great.
Wonderful. Mm. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming
thank
in.
You.
And thank you, John. Thank you. We're going to have a couple of other guests on. Og våre neste gjester, de vet ikke helt hva som kom først, forskningen eller kjærligheten.
Right.
Yes, I just... It's something in my brain that switched, so now I speak another language.
Oh, I see.
Setsuko Thurlow, welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you.
Now you live in Canada.